Hey everybody, and thanks for tuning in for another gaming episode from The Nostalgic Kid. If you haven't already, please hit the subscribe button and bell for future gaming content from the 80s, 90s, and 2000s. Today we will be reviewing the Super Nintendo, so sit back as we take a nostalgic flashback on this awesome console from the 90s. The Super Nintendo system, also known as the Super NES, is a 16-bit video game console developed by Nintendo, released in 1991 in North America and in Japan 1990. Which in Japan, the Super NES is called the Super Famicom. Nintendo was dominating the gaming market all through the 80s with the gaming hits like The Legend of Zelda, Castlevania, and Super Mario Bros. By the early 1990s, Nintendo owned 94% of the $3 billion gaming market, with one out of three households in America having an NES console. But there were new players in the gaming world. Two gaming platforms were launched in North America in 1989, one being the Sega Genesis and the other the TurboGrafx-16, both built with 16-bit chips that offered improved graphics and sound compared to the 8-bit NES. But Nintendo wasn't worried because of their new game release, Super Mario 3, and it was taking the world by storm. Nintendo could not make the game fast enough, with stores selling out within a day, becoming Nintendo's best-selling game. As for the TurboGrafx-16, it failed to break into the North American market and sold poorly, which has been blamed on the delayed release and inferior marketing campaign. Sega wanted to take their console to the next level and wanted to give Nintendo serious competition. It took several years for Sega to become successful, and Nintendo executives were in no hurry to put out a new system. But they reconsidered when they began to see that their dominance in the Japan market slipping. So Nintendo went to work. Development of the Super Famicom began in 1988 with the first images being shown to the public in the Famicom Shūshin magazine. The hardware engineering was directed by Masayuki Vimura. Vimura was the designer of the original Famicom, who came out of retirement to help design Nintendo's new console. Vimura designed the Super Famicom for visual and audio performance, rather than processing power, which the Sega Genesis had more of. The new Super NES could handle more than 128 sprites on screen and up to 4 layers at the same time. This console had up to 32,000 colors, however only 256 colors could be used simultaneously on screen. The Super Famicom could produce 8-channel 16-bit sound with two chips working harmoniously in concert. The controller resembled its old predecessor with its cross pad, but it was more ergonomic. With rounded edges, it had two more action buttons and it had two shoulder buttons. Speculation for the release of the console was suspected to be released in Japan in 1989 and in the United States the following summer. It was released in Japan on November 1990. The system cost around 25,000 yen, which was about 185 US dollars, and it didn't come with the game in the pack. But consumers had two choices to pick from, which was a futuristic racing car game called F-Zero, or Nintendo's famous mascot Mario with Super Mario World. The Super Famicom was pre-ordered by 1.5 million gamers, and the initial 300,000 consoles sold out within 2 hours. It also caught the attention of the Yakuza. Fun fact, the Yakuza, also known as Japanese gangsters, is a mafia-like criminal organization which uses samurai-like rituals and often bear elaborate body tattoos. The Yakuza engage in extortion, smuggling, prostitution, drug trafficking, loan sharking, and many other illegal activities. They plan to acquire huge quantities of Nintendo's product, or rather steal it, and then turn them into huge profits. Word reached Nintendo's president Hiroshi Yamauchi that the Yakuza plan to steal Nintendo's precious possessions. Yamauchi and the general affairs manager Hiroshi Imanashi came up with a plan straight out of a James Bond movie to fool the would-be thieves. Operation Midnight Shipping would commence on a cold November morning. Women quietly loaded unknown packages into large trucks. Without ceremony and fanfare, each truck took off from Kyoto and dispersed into the early morning night. Only the most essential members of the logistics team were given the full details about where and when the trucks would arrive, and other details from the manifest. Operation Midnight Shipping was a success. Thankfully, Japan awoke to its rising sun with 300,000 Super Famicoms dispersed across the nation, with not a single console stolen in transit. Back to the video. In the summer of 1991, the Super NES was launched in the United States. It came packed with Miyamoto's most popular game, Super Mario World. It helped push sales up. Super Mario World sold 3.5 million copies in Japan, while in the US, gamers bought 17 million. Retailers sold out of the Super NES console. It was an instant hit. By this time, Sega was on its offensive attack on Nintendo, which brought on the console wars. You can check it out in our other video called Short History of the Sega Genesis. Also, Sonic was fresh out the box, making Mario seem uncool and for little kids. By 1992, sources say that the Sega Genesis had 55% market share over Nintendo. Later that year, Nintendo faced another obstacle. Mortal Kombat, an ultra-violent two-player fighting game, was released on the SNES and Genesis. Although both systems looked the same on screen, one was different. The Sega Genesis version had all the blood and spine-ripping finishing moves, like the arcade. But the Super NES version was modified to reflect Nintendo's family-friendly policy. There were no fatalities with softening finish moves, and blood was turned into sweat. Sega's version sold more games than Nintendo's version, making Nintendo look bad to gamers who wanted the blood in the guts. But Nintendo continued up with the fight. At the end of the day, Nintendo just had better games that looked, sounded, and played better. Nintendo also had the support of Japan's top developers, SquareSoft, which helped create RPG series like Final Fantasy, Secret of Mana, and Chrono Trigger, which became popular in America. Nintendo continued to put out popular games like Street Fighter II, which was a success in the arcade. They also brought out the first party popular games like Zelda, A Link to the Past, Super Metroid, Super Mario Kart, Star Fox, and other popular titles. But Sega was still giving Nintendo competition, especially with their newly released game Aladdin. So seeking a game to compete with Aladdin, Nintendo bought a large minority stake in a British developer called Rareware that rendered 3D models. Nintendo gave Rareware the task to revive one of their famous mascots, Donkey Kong. Rareware assembled 12 developers to work on Donkey Kong Country. The game featured pre-rendered graphics that allowed the designers to convert 3D models into sprites without losing much detail. After the announcement at the Consumer Electronics Show, Donkey Kong Country was highly anticipated with a major marketing campaign that cost $16 million. It was released in November of 1994 and sold more than 9 million copies worldwide, becoming one of Nintendo's best-selling games. Donkey Kong Country helped Nintendo regain the reins of the video game market. Through the lifespan of the Super NES, there were peripherals that were produced to enhance gameplay, such as the Super Advantage controller that had a joystick and large buttons to make it feel like you were playing at the arcade. Also, Nintendo released a mouse for games like Mario Paint. Mario Paint featured a drawing board, animation land, a music composition feature, and a coloring book. The Super Scope was another peripheral that Nintendo released. It was bundled with a 6-game cartridge that allowed you to use a scope to shoot away at targets. But there was one game that everyone wanted to play, and it was Terminator 2. Terminator 2 was a blockbuster hit in the early 90s, which had many gamers excited. Another must-have was the Super Game Boy, which allowed gamers to play their Game Boy games on the Super NES, which in turn helped improve the gameplay on Game Boy games. Then in 1997, Nintendo released the Super NES 2, which was a smaller version of the Super NES. Nintendo made this version for new gamers who were still playing the 16-bit games. It was cheaper to make and less expensive for consumers. Many believe that the Super Nintendo was being redesigned to incorporate the rumored CD-based attachment with Sony. Since 1988, Nintendo and Sony were working together on a console that would play cartridges and CDs. But their partnership was on shaky ground because Nintendo wanted a lot more control and didn't know how to split profits. Despite the unhappy relationship, they continued to work together. In 1991, at the CES, Consumer Electronics Show, a presentation of their new console was dubbed the Nintendo PlayStation. Sony's future with Nintendo looked promising. What a difference a day makes! The next day after the presentation, Nintendo broke its contract with Sony and went with Sony's rival, Philips. Philips had been working on their own CD-based console, the CD-i, since 1984, bringing it to market in 1991. Nintendo wanted Philips to make the CD add-on device for their 16-bit consoles. This was a slap in the face for Sony. Little did Nintendo know at that time that it had created a monster. Overall, the Super Nintendo was a great hit, selling more than 49 million consoles worldwide. Although it could not repeat the success of its famous predecessor, the NES, that sold more than 61 million units. In 2008, Gaming Excellence gave the Super NES first place, declaring it simply the most timeless system ever created, with many games that stand out from the rest, and its innovation in design, graphics, and game storytelling. The Super Nintendo will always have a special place in my heart. What were your favorite games on the Super NES? Let us know in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe for future gaming content from the Nostalgia Kid.